Trade facilitation clearly was an issue that was a higher relevance for business. Therefore, you saw a lot of interest. I would argue ITA is another area where I could not argue in any shape or form, and we shouldn't, that the business sector has not been engaged in the negotiation in WTO. On the contrary, so I don't see there is any challenge from the point of view of interest of business in WTO work when you clearly can identify the relevance. But there are a number of other things where you logically don't see interest of the business because it's not that relevant for their bottom line issues. Now that leads then to the question of, okay, so what are the issues that the WTO should deal with in order to sustain or to have perhaps attract more interest by business? And that's, I think, is a more relevant question than just to view it as an existential problem whether business is there or not. I mean, business shouldn't be there if the issues are not relevant, because then they're actually investing resources in something that doesn't matter to them. So for me, the basic challenge we have then leads into the setup of the negotiations. In other words, how do we filter issues for negotiations in such a way that it attracts interest and becomes relevant for business? There, I'll be honest with you, I'm now speaking as a former negotiator for the EU, and working on industrial goods, which is a natural issue of very large interest by business, including non-tariff measures, which was again an issue that industry picked up and wanted to push very hard in the DDA. The sentiment in business sector was that ultimately a number of actors, the WTO system as a whole, as well as sometimes the EU, sacrificed industrial goods, i.e. manufacturing sector, at the altar of agriculture narrow interests. If that setup continues, there will always be an inherent sense that manufacturing industry has less to get out of the WTO, because in the end, if there is a trade-off, the agriculture side will win. And I think that's something which, if the WTO is serious about bringing industry in, we'll have to think about. Should there be trade-offs between a manufacturing interest and an agricultural interest? Should there, which happened in the DDA, by the way, the NTMs got on the back burner, although all business were saying actually they mattered more than the tariff part, which in any case was a formula and a flex, which actually did not provide real market access. So I think there are a number of things we have to ask ourselves with respect to the setup. The second issue is, if we're talking about global value chains, which in the end, that would be a lot of the interest coming from business in the way that WTO through its rules can facilitate regional and global value chains. Well, is it logical then to slice up between the tariff part, the NTB part, the services part, and the data part? From a global value chain perspective, i.e. from a bottom line issue of business, you can't really, it's artificial to try to deal with a goods schedule versus a services schedule versus what you do in NTMs or TBT, technical barriers to trade, the standards, conformity requirements, compared to what you do in services, compared to what you do in on the data issues. And I think that's where, if we are serious about wanting to have engagement by the private sector, I think there, in my view, although ITA is a great agreement, it was a lost opportunity to try to have a value add chain perspective on ITA. ITA would have been even more interesting for business if we would have been able to deal with the tariff, non-tariff services and the data related to the ICT and ITA sectors. And I think that's also, as a negotiator, as a bureaucrat, you have to adjust to the demand. And unfortunately, there is an institutional stickiness that does not allow us to the demand by business, which actually is that we deal with issues integrated and that we deal with them partly a little bit more sectoral. Instead of silos, sectoral. In other words, you can have a discussion on the telecom industry without having to talk about food security. And I think that's the second part. Now, I think you want me to comment finally on the institutional setup of the WTO. Is there a way that the WTO could become more interesting for business by institutional amendments? In my view, no. In the end, people come when people care. And it's not so much about whether there's an open door or not. In my view, business are very skilled to lobby at all levels, national, regional, and as well global level, if they have an interest and it's worth the investment to convey their interest. So I don't see any possibility or any real reason to institutionalize a mechanism in the WTO for closer dialogue between business and members in the negotiations in WTO. I do think, however, that the mere fact that this trade and development seminar is taking place in a different location than the conference center is somewhat of a ridiculous feature of WTO ministerials. And that's basically because they're stuck on this issue of Arab League, meaning also, for example, the organization I represent cannot have an official status as a UN agency in WTO. But that's not so much about business. This is just a phenomenon of the fact that the WTO has not figured out even how to make sure that there is, you make use of the ministerials as a proper convening power for all different actors that have an interest. So fundamentally, yes, business is very interested in trade policy, and by the way, so are many other segments of society. They are interested in particular aspects of the WTO, but unfortunately the setup, the timing issues of the WTO negotiations does not always bode well for business investing their time and their money in trying to influence. Thank you.
Thank you, Joaquim. Let me welcome Kiwami Owino, who is the chief executive of the Institute of Economic Affairs, and just join us. Let me use this opportunity, since Joaquim will have to leave in a little while. Are there any questions, given the points that he just made? Yep. No? At the end, he will not be here anymore. So, yes, that's a good strategy. Okay. Okay, no questions at this point in time. Bernard.
So the title of this session is Future of the WTO and How to Rekindle the business interest. So I think one initial point I would make is to make a distinction between what Joaquim and what many people kind of automatically think about when they think about the WTO and business interest that's in this, the rulemaking, the negotiating process, right? And of course there's a lot more to the WTO than that. So I think if we think about where is business interested, and there are different dimensions, of course, of the trading system, and one of them relates to the acquis. In a sense, there's been a lot already negotiated in the past. There are many agreements in place. Those are actively used by business in the sense that they're very keen to see those agreements implemented, enforced, and therefore you have this committee structure in the WTO that deals with technical barriers to trade, that deals with sanitary and phytosanitary restrictions, and so forth. And ultimately, if there are disputes between countries, then we have the dispute settlement system. So those are all kind of, I think, elements of the WTO where there's very active engagement by governments, but of course those governments, everything those governments do is because there's a business interest behind a particular intervention or behind a particular dispute or behind a particular process. And I think that process is something that is very much neglected in terms of what the WTO is all about. And so I think that's number one. Now, it's very difficult to measure kind of engagement or interest, but obviously, again, just the mere fact that this is happening on a day-to-day basis, day in, day out, suggests that we actually have a very important system which is actually being used by and for business. Now, obviously, it's not only about business. Ultimately, this is all about consumer interests, right? I mean, the whole point of the process is to reduce barriers to trade, which will allow consumers to have access to lower cost, higher quality goods and services. But anyway, that's the one point. It's not just about negotiations. Turning to the negotiation side of things, I think the big kind of elephant in the room for me is, again, maybe piggybacking a bit on what Joaquim said, the way the process has been designed, it focuses on agriculture, it focuses on non-agricultural market access, so the industrial, mostly tariff agenda, as was mentioned, and then we have services. If you look at contributions to GDP today in the world, services account for 70-80% of GDP in the rich countries, over 50-60% of GDP in developing countries, right? And the way the negotiations were structured is basically a decision was made that first we deal with agriculture and NAMA, and then we'll start talking about services. So in one fell swoop, you immediately took 80% of your constituency, basically said, you guys will have to wait. And they have been waiting for a long time, right? So I think that is, explains, to a large extent, to me at least, the disconnect. And then if you think about industry, most of what industry now sells are services, right? So there's this process of servitization of manufacturing. So in a sense, what industrial firms are being paid for are products that provide services, and increasingly a large number of these firms actually think about themselves as providing services. So I think for me that is the big thing that is missing from the equation. Now, of course, there's been a process to take services out of the Doha negotiations, so there's an ongoing process to negotiate a trade in services agreement, but that is not particularly inclusive. Some of the major players in the world economy have been essentially, in my view, excluded from that process. China is of course the main example. So there again, from a business point of view, if you think, where are my markets, where do I want to see things happen, where do I want to see commitments being made that will improve the certainty of the policy regime that I'm operating in, essentially in TISA you have a bunch of countries that actually have, you know, pretty good services regulation, and the ones that you really want to be engaging with are not there. So I've been involved and been participating in meetings with businesses where essentially they were telling their negotiators, you know, it's really great that you guys are at least doing something on the services front, but, you know, even if we get a deal, I'm not going to call my CEO at 6 o'clock in the morning and say, here, there's a deal. I could certainly do that if we had a deal that involved China, Brazil, India. So again, I think, you know, it's I think that is one of the elements that is needed to rekindle. We need to bring those issues back to the table, which means we need to bring those countries into the process, and currently that's not happening. And I think that is unlikely to happen in the context of these mega regionals. I mean, that's my view. So I think ultimately these are things that have to be brought back to the WTO. And I think if we really want to rekindle interest in the negotiating process, then that would be certainly something that, in my view, would get people a lot more excited than they are today. So I think those were my two kind of basic points. In terms of process, I disagree a little bit with Joachim in terms of how the officials, the governments, actually engage with business in the context of the WTO. And I certainly agree that if business has an interest, they will lobby. Many firms are very efficient at lobbying, but they're going to be lobbying for very specific things. And I think what we're missing in the WTO context is a process which is a bit more systemic, where you can actually identify issues that matter to a large number of industries, not just a particular firm. Of course, SMEs, which account for the bulk of employment, don't really have good access to these mechanisms. They have to work through industry associations. So I think there is, in my view, there has been lacking in the WTO enough of a kind of reality check. And I think the Doha round itself exemplifies that, right? So we start off designing something in 2001. We have this approach of agriculture first. And we don't have mechanisms that are effective enough to say, okay, we need a mid-course correction here. And I think that's partly due to the fact, I would argue, that there isn't enough of a way to actually engage with constituencies to say, okay, is this really still where the mass of the interests lie? Are these really still important issues from an economic growth, welfare, development point of view? That's kind of lacking. So yes, we discuss these things in this symposium, but you don't have enough of that, I think, in the WTO. Now, how you do that, how you mobilize that type of interest and attention is a different story, but I do think it is missing. And I think the other part of the lobbying game, which of course happens all the time, is one of equity, of essentially equality of access. So I think that again is something that a more formal process of deliberation, engagement, I don't like the word consultation, but I think it really needs to be a more formal process where it actually is all about providing information, feedback, and essentially holding everybody accountable, including the business community itself, in terms of what they should be doing. So I think there is something missing there, and we can talk about how best perhaps to think about how you might do more of that. So let me stop there.
Very good. And before we give the floor to Doug, so that he tell us if he's going to call his CEO by Friday in terms of the results in Nairobi, let's use this opportunity, since there was no question for Joaquin, now we have a point of contention. So what is your reaction to Bernard's point?
Well, he had made 3 points, but on the acquis versus negotiations, that's absolutely correct. On the systemic change in terms of the some form of formal process of deliberation, I think that was the point. The problem actually is that I cannot see. You need to have a polity, if you want, at the global level, which you could argue the WTO is. I would argue the WTO is the sum of its members, i.e. it's the responsibility of the members to make sure that they have a vetting process, of the, which, by the way, is not only about business, but certainly consumer groups or any other group, since trade policy has a distributional effect, we're talking about people that are going to be affected. So you need to have an open stakeholder process, which includes trade unions, consumer groups. But the manner in which you set that up nationally is for every government to decide. I don't think if you do it at a global level that you would ever get close to equality in access. I think it will be a bunch of large multinationals, some of the most vocal NGOs, and perhaps some of the most aggressive trade unions. I don't think that provides any form of constructive, or what was called mid-course correction reality checks. I think it will be a lot of blood on the floor and people throwing pie at each other. So I think that's the basic problem I have. I mean, it's even difficult in the EU to do this at the EU level. We still rely heavily on the proper consultation mechanism that we have at national levels, where we can assess, are we ensuring that everyone is well represented when we devise our policies at national level. Even at EU level, this has been very difficult. So I like the objective, especially equality and access. It's just that I don't think it's possible to get there.
I think this is really the design issue that I was alluding to. But at the end of the day, this bottom-up process obviously helps define for governments what they should be pushing for. But at the same time, I think there is a collective action agenda here. There is a public good. And I think a lot of this, I go back to the value chain kind of issue that was mentioned by Joachim. A lot of the kind of interests span many, many countries nowadays, right? So we have investments in multiple markets. We have, it's not just about particular policy instruments that you're focusing only on the tariff. You made the point that NTMs is really where the action is. That's a much more complex agenda. Services is, of course, a big beast in itself, but very important for the operation of value chains. We have the whole digital economy, e-commerce. There's a whole slew of issues that are kind of coming up all the time, where I don't think we have enough. And I think the national bottom-up process, to me, doesn't really address those issues very effectively. So I think we do need to have some kind of a cross-cutting approach, which it might not be for the WTO, right? So that's part of this design issue. I think a lot of these questions actually get addressed much more, I wouldn't necessarily say effectively, but much more clearly and concretely in contexts like the OECD, APEC, in principle, UNCTAD, could be a forum for this, but I think we need to have, I think that really is, to some extent it's there, and I think this is also reflected in the mega regionals. And again, as I said, we have it in APEC, OECD, we don't have it in the WTO, and I think that is something that's missing.
Very good. So, Doug, are you going to call your CEO?
Well, I'd like to have a reason to. I'd like to cover four points. The first is, when you're talking about engagement of the private sector with the WTO, I think there is some work still to be done in terms of awareness raising. And I see it as a two-way street. We mentioned SMEs. I think there is, in talking with clients and others, in the small and medium enterprise sector, there is a lack of awareness of possibilities to contribute, to engage. I think also, as a two-way street, I think there's room also for awareness raising on the part of the Secretariat of the WTO. There's very few practitioners of trade that are actually engaged in the process of negotiating trade deals. That is, those who've actually conducted trade, who've been occupied with figuring out how to conduct a transaction, to load goods on a ship, or upload a digital product and send it across the internet to a customer. So I think there's room for cross-fertilization in both directions. Third point I'd like to make is that I think it's important to have incremental progress along the way. This gap of 14 years that Carlos alluded to at the beginning is too long to go without having a deliverable. And I see that if we can find a way to make incremental progress, then we can have the periodic consolidation of the gains and the generalization of the of what works. I'd like to say a few more words about each of these points. I think, first of all, it's important to acknowledge that in the aftermath of Seattle and the launching of the Doha Round, that the WTO did undertake some notable efforts to improve transparency of operation, to improve consultation through the public forum, which has become quite an important opportunity, I think, for exchanges of views, and to improve the availability of documents. The website has really been built out. I can find a lot more than I could 10 years ago. I think that needs to be acknowledged. But yes, of course, the sustained lack of progress on new liberalization, it dampens the interest of the private sector. Since the Information Technology Agreement number one in 1997, we've had some further progress in liberalization via accessions to the WTO. I think that's important to note with China, Taiwan, Russia, et cetera. We've had some expansion of liberalization under multilateral rules, which is encouraging. But of course, accessions are a limited growth channel, and we need to find, we need to begin making progress in other areas. I think it's important to find a way to engage the private sector, and in my time working for OECD and now working for HSBC, I've seen a few examples of this where channels have been developed. I mean, the ILO is one example where you have a tripartite structure, probably too radical to propose in the context of the WTO. But there's some lighter versions of this that we might consider. The OECD has a structure called the Business Industry Advisory Committee, which is engaged. The staff, the secretariat for this BIAC, are actually part of the OECD secretariat. There's an official channel whereby business is consulted or able to make views known about the policy debates that are going on in the OECD. And I think that's an interesting structure that's built in. This year I've been engaged with the B20, G20 process, which is another approach. And I think that there's lots of opportunities there for businesses to consult among themselves. It's partly with the support of the Chamber of Commerce, International Chamber of Commerce, but for businesses to consult among themselves and to discern what are their priorities and then to articulate these to the highest levels of government in the G20 countries. And I think that process is actually quite interesting. Instead of bombarding policymakers with a multitude of demands, it's a way of sorting through things and consolidating and having a coherent way of approaching policymakers with business views. I think that there's an asymmetry in the, Joachim hinted at this as well, that there's an asymmetry in the WTO. Businesses may care deeply about a narrow issue, and it makes it difficult to, the material covered in the agreements is complex, it's detailed. If you look at the tariff schedules, businesses may care deeply about a single line in the tariff code. It makes it difficult to manage the process, to ensure that the appropriate stakeholders are consulted at each step. And I think it's not enough to rely on businesses to be aware, to bring to their national government's attention their priorities, and then have the government officials take this further into the WTO. There needs to be more awareness of what's going on, engagement directly, in order to ensure that these kinds of asymmetries can be tackled. I think that we could have a periodic consultative mechanism, something like the semi-annual or annual business consultation day, you know, to maybe one very informal way to launch this expansion of engagement and consultation. I've seen this in other organizations, and it's a way to take stock without having to build a new institutional arrangement that's heavy. I would say that it's important to have as well this incremental progress. I think plurilateral agreements are an important way to do that, where you can have like-minded countries engage and push forward in the liberalization effort in a particular area, like we've had with ITA. I'd like to see TISA as well advance and be integrated into the WTO framework. And I think that it's important to have periodic monitoring of what works and to consult with business on the actual operation of the agreements in practice, to take that information back in, and then eventually to have the big round where these incremental steps are brought together, where what works is acknowledged and then integrated in a big round to be generalized across the WTO membership with due accord to special and differential treatment and the need to take capacities into account and all of the good things that the WTO does very well. But I think that that we need to have some deliverables along the way. These 15-year increments are too long to go without having some substantial progress. So, thank you.
Thank you, Doug. And you raised the issue about different fora in which negotiations are evolving. Later we may come back to this topic, because my experience, for instance, if I go to Washington to give a talk about the implications of TPP for the rest of the world, there is a room full of people that want to engage. If I go to talk about MC10, there are less people than here. So is there a way, let's say, to pursue the plurilateral route in a more effective way under the umbrella of the WTO? We may come back to this. But Stefan, what ICC has to tell us about the interest of the private sector?
Thank you very much, Carlos. Well, we come at it from a very interested standpoint, because ICC was created in 1919 to further cross-border trade and investment. So really the WTO is the main intergovernmental body that is the custodian of a set of global trading rules is really a key interlocutor for us. It's at the center of the global trading architecture for us, and it's a key interlocutor for our organization. So in terms of our interest in the institution called the WTO and its mission, that's unquestionable. The problem has been, I would say, that because of the challenges in keeping the negotiating pillar of the WTO alive and well and producing things, for all of the reasons that have been mentioned by the previous speakers, the interest of, individual companies as opposed to institutional actors such as ourselves, has ebbed and flowed for very good reasons. And this is why, I think here you see a relatively small contingent of business representatives. Many of them represent institutions for whom this engagement is important and for whom from a perception standpoint, presence here in order to signal the support for the multilateral trading system is important, as opposed to any particular narrow interest that they might want to see looked after. But the two aren't necessarily contradictory, and normally at more successful ministerials or potentially more successful ministerials, you'll see more of a blend of that. Let me just say also that ICC does two things in the policy realm, which I guess sets us apart from most business organizations, but I think explains also the credibility that we may have in terms of being a business interlocutor for the WTO. There was a mention by Doug of the fact that there was a lack of engagement by practitioners of international trade in this, and it was more of a discussion for negotiator cognoscenti of the process. ICC does two things in the policy realm. We do policy advocacy, which is kind of traditional lobbying, quote unquote, which is to try influence processes that are usually intergovernmental processes, but in some cases have become multi-stakeholder processes, where we feel it's important for global business to have a voice and as a representative of global business cross-sectorally and broadly dispersed geographically, we feel we can bring to the table. So that's the, you know, the traditional, I guess, activity of business organizations. But ICC has also an important normative role in that it is a producer of rules and standards that are voluntary, but they are developed by business for the use of business, and that we feel are oiling the wheels of trade, as we call it. So I can give a couple of examples of this. We have had, since the 1930s, developed by ICC, rules that govern the use of documentary credits, which is basically a paper-based form, but increasingly electronic form of financing of international trade transactions, which is now one of several, but still a very prevalent one. And when these rules were created, it was the only way to finance international trade transactions. And these rules are applied by banks all over the world. And the WTO, for example, in full acquiescence of the importance of having trade finance as an enabler of international trade, created a working group on trade finance. This was an initiative of a previous DG, Pascal Lamy, where the private sector was brought in, ourselves, but also banks, such as the institution that Doug works for, which are main purveyors of trade finance. So there is, you know, there is a lot of engagement. One thing that had been done also by a previous DG was the setting up of informal advisory groups. I don't know if you remember. This was under DG Supachai, where you had a sort of a business advisory group, you had a sort of more multi-stakeholder advisory group. Again, these were non-institutional forms of cooptation of different types of stakeholders to be brought into a more permanent process of dialogue with the institution itself and with the WTO Secretariat. So the fact that we produce the rules is an important element in the credibility, I think, that we have vis-a-vis the WTO and policymakers in terms of the policy recommendations we do on the policy advocacy side. And the combination of the two is important. Just to talk a little bit more, because we come at this with very much of an interest in the system, right? And this may set us apart from other types of business organizations. You have narrower business organizations, which are sectoral bodies, which are regional business bodies, national business bodies, and, you know, it's perfectly legitimate for them to do so, but they come at it with a narrower interest. But business is, I think, a sophisticated actor, and they will use a combination of these various institutions like keys on a piano to play a melody, and they will use them, you know, to varying degrees depending on what type of goal they have. So they'll go to their sectoral body if they have a narrow policy goal that they would like to see trade policy achieve, or they will come to an institution such as us if they're interested in longer-term collective business action to support the establishment and the continued maintenance of a vibrant set of global trade rules that both liberalize global trade on an MFN basis, but also create new rules to address new issues in international trade. And that's very much our interest in this. So, you know, whereas some people would think that we come at this in this kind of, you know, lofty, esoteric way, we do, because that's our role. We really have this role as a business voice that is the guardian of the multilateral trading system. So we, as you know, the priority number one, I would say, for us is maintaining the effectiveness of the multilateral trading system. And I think today that means, at least on the systemic level, having better coherence between the global trade rules, of which the WTO is a custodian on the one hand, and the emerging mega-regionals mainly on the other. And unless we find some practical, concrete ways, and by that I don't necessarily mean changing, you know, Article 24 of the GATT or Article 5 of the GATT, that's proven to be very difficult, and there have been, you know, never-ending discussions about this, but the WTO members have also come up with practical mechanisms that are stuck in the Doha stasis, but that have you know, very concrete implications in terms of the Secretariat's capacity to look at these preferential trade agreements, analyze them, and see what for us is you know, should be the finality of this exercise, is what elements of these mega regionals or other types of preferential deals could be multilateralized. We have a strong preference for multilateral trade liberalization, so we would have a strong preference for these trade liberalization and investment liberalization undertakings to be carried out within the WTO. But absent that, and given the configuration, we would like to see more effort and greater capacity on the part of the WTO to integrate these new developments into the corpus of global trade rules. And that would apply also to sort of plurilateral efforts like the TISA, for example. Second, I think if business is going to sustain its interest in this, and we as a global business organization very much depend on the expertise and the engagement of the companies, the corporates, right, not only the institutional actors, to do this. So it is important to sustain that interest. There have to be some tangible outcomes, and that's incontrovertible. I said yesterday that ICC has pushed very hard for putting trade facilitation on the agenda of the WTO back in 1996 in Singapore at the first ministerial. And it took us basically from 1996 to 2013 to get an agreement on trade facilitation. Now, we understand that these processes are long, and look at how long it took us to have an agreement on climate change. So this collective business action at a global level to negotiate multilateral deals has to be sustained over time. But nonetheless, there needs to be some tangible results along the way. So the TFA was one. It is tangible. We are only 57 WTO members having ratified it, and that's short of 107 or 108 that we need. But this stands to benefit business in a very tangible way. ITA, same thing. It would be a shame, I think, if Nairobi didn't move forward on this, and this is in the interest of everybody. And I think the ITA provides an interesting model because it's an open plurilateral where the benefits of what's negotiated go to all. Everybody has an interest in seeing that carried through, and maybe that can apply to other areas. And there are also important elements that have to do with a better integration of least developed countries and developing countries into the global trading system through very concrete, simple things like, duty-free, quota-free, where if we didn't see any progress of that in Nairobi, I think it would be fairly difficult to understand why. Environmental goods. That's another thing that's very much dans l'air du temps. It would show tangibly how the trade system can contribute to mitigation and adaptation of a trade contribution to addressing the climate change problem. And clearly it's difficult to understand how, on the one hand, there is a huge amount of uptake in Paris for an agreement on climate change, and relatively less movement in the WTO in terms of moving that part of the agenda forward. And lastly, I would say that trade and investment are going to be pretty important enablers of achieving the SDGs. And this is going to be the new framework within which we conceive of global development and how to address global development challenges in an integrated way, trade and investment have to be a part of that. And I would say that my last point in terms of forward-looking issues that the WTO, but probably not only the WTO, will have to address is the issue of investment. I think investment is absolutely key to most of the current challenges. Services, for example, I think you can deal with a lot of domestic regulatory barriers to services trade by dealing with investment regimes. Financing for development is about mobilization of domestic resources and investment. SDGs is about investment. Climate change is about investment. So unless we find a way to move forward the thinking about some kind of a common framework to address trade-related investment issues in a WTO context, but in other IGOs that have done work on this, we're going to be falling behind, and we're going to see ways to address these in different ways, which we're seeing in the mega regionals. So that's what I would leave you with.
Very good, very poetic. I particularly like the fact that corporations can play the different parts of the piano and to make a symphony. But one obvious question here is, what does this mean for a country like Kenya? and particularly when we see the proliferation of preferential agreements and particularly the mega preferentials, what does this mean for Kenya and what does the WTO mean for Kenya other than bringing lots of people to Nairobi once in a lifetime?
Thank you, Carlos. And thanks, everyone. My name is Kwame Owino. I work at the Institute of Economic Affairs, and my apologies for coming in late. I didn't have an identification document, so I had to go and get it. I think we are discussing how we can rekindle private sector interest in WTO. And I think to start with just a polemical point, the preface, or rather the assumption there is that private sector has either insufficient interest or no interest at all in stuff so far. And I think one of the speakers who spoke earlier spoke about the fact that we need to appreciate that the WTO is not just a negotiating forum. It has a good number of institutions doing fantastic work. For instance, trade dispute settlement, I think that's one of the highlights. It doesn't receive as much attention as it is, for instance, in a place like Kenya, but I think it's a very, very solid and competent body. So that's the first point. The second point is that the difficulties that are inherent in how the WTO works, or the challenges as I may call them, are themselves reflections of the fact that it was formed in one way, in which all countries with different interests come together. At the same time, those interests are not necessarily just because of the multilateral system, but basically they reflect differences in the domestic part. So for instance, in Kenya, what we call trade negotiation positions are not themselves entirely solid in the sense that, I mean, they may reflect who has domestic political power and is able therefore to fashion those as necessarily the national interest. So if we start with those, I'll ask myself then, because, so what should we do? And I divide my point into three. One of the things that I'll ask myself is then what governments should do, because I think governments are the people, or states, are the ones that bear responsibilities and rights within the WTO system. And then I'll come down to what's the business role. And the final point is basically even the institution of the WTO, what could it do independently and within the space that it has, noting that obviously I think the competent staff of the WTO often remind people that let's remember that whatever is on our table is precisely what we are allowed to do by our membership, and we do not have independent initiative to bring in anything, even if we think it would be useful for the system as a whole. So what should governments do? To my mind, I think one of the biggest problems that we see is that business collectives or business associations in Kenya, in the region, to a large extent still have, I mean, it may be unbelievable for many of you, I think trade is used coterminously with exports. So those who have the capability to export have so much more power in a country like Kenya, in the region, I would think, and perhaps in the sub-Saharan African continent. And what that does then is that the positions regarding exports or agriculture is only seen as, look, it's about thinking about how we expand our ability to gain on the other side, which is fine. But as we all know, for a multilateral trade agreement, then, I mean, facility, then that's really, really difficult, because then it talks about this tends to generate standoffs about unless we get this or unless we get that. Now, my view is that it's upon government, which obviously tries to coalesce the interests of different people, different business groups in a country such as this, to remember, look, I think we need a little bit more balance, because that also makes us adopt more realistic positions at the multilateral level, which allows us to grease and to get the agreements going forward, especially with negotiations and all that. So that the first thing is, I think, is for governments or at the domestic level for that idea and a sensitivity towards the fact that, look, we have, I think we need to adopt a far more sensitive position than just the fact that we are using the WTO and we are using our negotiations to be able to expand exports. That may be true in other places, but I think it's particularly salient in Kenya. So that's the first. The second is, I think, and this has been mentioned, I think an extremely harmful, in quote marks, focus again on goods and not on services. Even in a country such as Kenya, agriculture is big, but it's only 23% of GDP. Well, it's been expanding, funnily enough, I think. But it's 23% of GDP. Then, of course, we have services. And one of the things that many African governments are interested in is manufacturing. But manufacturing, as we also heard, and I think is important because of the global value chains, which many African countries would like to hinge on, would be nowhere without services. Because I think right now, all goods and services represent a package of some level of services together with that. Whether African countries can compete in that is a different matter altogether, but I think bringing in the service levels, I mean, or rather the voices of service associations and private sector service associations, in my view, is also important here. And if we find that, then we'll find that some of the positions that have to be taken or the appreciation of what the WTO's role is would actually become necessarily more complex, but I think a little more educated to the fact that this is not it. So that's the second. The third point about what government should do, I think there's this fragmentation that goes around. The theory that is given out there by political economists and trade analysts is because that there's frustration with Doha. For that reason, everybody's trying to cover themselves by going into the different coalitions. I think within Kenya itself, for instance, this country in which you're sitting has commitments, forgetting the bilateral ones, commitments in the East African community, it has commitments in COMESA, then of course you hear about the TPP that's coming up, and but my thinking is that anybody who understands this, and this again is just something that the trade practitioners and those who negotiate within government will have to know, I think the days of trying to claw new advantages through a separation of, I've been thinking about what we can't get at the WTO, then let's try and slice it into smaller agreements, in my view, is that it'll reach a dead end, and I think it'll be painful, in my view, especially for countries such as this. So that's a strategic choice or a tactical choice that countries would have to make, partly because you can only slice one pie so many times. And in addition to the fact that, of course, that spaghetti bowl, as it's called, will over time generate even more complicated trade policy and more disputes in my view. So obviously governments have to say, look, we are committed to a multilateral system. To the extent that we can, most of the things that will go in at these levels, ask businesses, please give us proposals that are WTO plus, for instance, or that require us, that do not necessarily violate what we believe on the other side. So those of these, most of them involve political work, but most of them also involve trade policy being more coherent at the national level at these in capitals. Let's go now to the business role. The role of businesses is different because I also think, and this is not necessarily to just split hairs, but also because businesses are not homogeneous. Even within Kenya, the small and micro businesses are really small. They're really, really small. I mean, what people call small businesses in Europe here would be extremely large businesses. For that reason, their focus tends to be the domestic market. They haven't yet got to the institutional level where they're thinking about the possibility of exports. So that's one. Two, in Kenya, export firms, and some of them are very, very successful, are minority. For that reason, again, it ties back to government. They tend to have very, very big voices in trade policy, and especially at the regional level, tend to get quite some audience from government. So one, I think it goes back to saying that if you understand the more complicated or more nuanced picture, then obviously the smaller trading institutions need to come up a little bit together, get a view about where, how far back and what a multilateral trading system provides for them. And to also understand that as exporters, they consume other services which may be imported, which then allow them to also participate more meaningfully. So at that level, I think the business roles of the bigger firms, which are very, very institutionalized and have come with Kenya for, or within the region for a while and have connections throughout the region, I'm not too sure how to make them moderate their demands. But I think what could be made available to them through academia and other people who engage in this is to let them know, look, beggar thy neighbor policies always come back painfully. I think they fall back. And at the same time, what this does, as I think partly is responsible for what happened in agriculture, the non-governmental organizations which have their own claims up there actually support some of the views that some business constituencies in Kenya think about, which is, if we can't get our way, let's collapse the system. I think that's it. It's impolite to say, but it's true. Many of them are like the fact that, look, if we cannot get our own expansion, then let's freeze things. So in a view, some public education around what it means for these very long, or rather the lengthening periods and extended periods all here means you're freezing so many opportunities and all that. In a way as well, I think that business people in sometimes are very realistic and they're able to. I think we should concentrate on the victories that we have, perhaps work with governments for instance, within this region to ensure that what we have, such as trade facilitation, the agreement and all that, gets the numbers that are required to do. One, because it gets some confidence that, fine, this is what will happen, but also for a country such as Kenya and many developing countries, but in particular, the trade facilitation agreement, if it comes through, has a lot of enormous gains, obviously, spread throughout society, but mostly for businesses as well. So coming down to what the WTO would be, I also think that the WTO on its own may require, out of the motion of its director general, or perhaps just those who work within it, find some ways to actually go out there and find out from, well, that would probably be scholars again, perhaps my bias, but also business groups and all other people to speak about. Okay, because we have a problem, or rather we have a structure that allows us to negotiate on a sectoral basis, which I think is also part of it, slicing and dicing the economy into sectors that individually may make sense, but when you try to put it together, it leads to interesting outcomes. What do you think is an agenda that would be useful for everybody else, is probably coherent and puts as many of these things together in a way that then allows us to get back to members or even to business collectives or coalitions and ask them to perhaps put some, negotiate with governments or try to advocate with governments to bring it before us. So the business advisory group, I think, is one good thing. We may have others that are comprised of academia without formal status, but just basically one way of putting in or putting together these threads in a way that presents a coherent whole. If, in my view, if that was to happen, well, it would probably add to the workload of those who are in the WTO, who I think already deal with so much. But my thinking is that it's important to have a coherent, to try and bring together coherent things. Because as I think, we are too fixated right now on agriculture, and it is very, very important. But as we can tell, 70, 60, 70% of all services that people consume, of what people consume is already outside agriculture, and obviously without them, agriculture wouldn't do well. So that's my thinking. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Very interesting, and I'm so happy that I lived long enough to hear we are too fixated on agriculture, because there was a moment in history of the GATT and pre-WTO years that agriculture was not even there. So, I agree that's a problem and also an issue, as was discussed, in terms of the interest of the private sector. So before we open for questions, anything from the panel that you would like to add, and particularly questions for Joaquin, I can answer on his behalf. Joaquin, for those who just arrived, had to leave because he had another commitment. So anything that you guys would like to add, Stefano?
Just one point that maybe I didn't make too clearly in terms of going forward. Again, negotiating things multilaterally, and multilateralism does matter, and WTO is the forum for doing that. And there are certain things that you can only negotiate at a multilateral level. You're not going to get an agreement on agriculture to lower agricultural trade barriers between, say, the EU and China, because the US is if the US is not part of that game, then that's not going to happen. So there are certain things that it does make sense to negotiate multilaterally. At the same time, there is need for a certain degree of progress for those WTO members that want to move forward in smaller groups, in a more plurilateral approach. The important thing is that this be done in an open way, so that eventually other WTO members can accede to those agreements. And I think that unless the WTO finds its way in terms of the balance between those two things, then it's going to be very difficult to make progress.
Questions, signs of despair. Yes, please. Roving mic.
Okay, so good morning.
Morning.
So my name is Fabian from Kenya. And I think my question goes to actually this question between Ghana and the country. So they spoke about the framework of the WTO. They spoke about the framework. I know that, for example, sometimes you have disputes that go from being trade disputes
to transfer of intelligent solutions, and at the same time, between regions, sometimes it's between countries.
Now, how can the future?
And needs others to help.
How does the WTO envision a process where they're able first of all to distinguish between, you know, if the dispute is actually a trade dispute or a political dispute? For example, sometimes we have situations here that warrant for travel advice. And when there is both, then they negatively affect. You know, there's generally reason for those shared for those travel. But then what happens is after a while, then, you know, it extends too long, and before you know it, then a sector is collapsing, and that sector collapses, and then collapses another sector. And that affects trade, it affects the GDP of the country, it affects the way of lives of people that are involved. And, you know, then you just wonder, I mean, if there's an institution like the WTO, why is it not able to distinguish and help resolve these disputes? Also, other times you have issues to do with, like poaching, you know, a problem that is common here. And they poach here, but what is poached here is sold in other markets, you know. And when that happens, then what exactly, how is WTO going to help a country that is in need for them to put in stringent measures to make sure that what is being done here and is being done against the will of the country does not become a business opportunity for someone else in another region. Thank you.
Very good. We probably need a whole day to address these questions, but I'm going to ask Bernard to start.
On the the dispute settlement, again, to me that points to kind of potentially an area where you could put this forward in a WTO type of context, issue area, where you say, okay, this is something which is not being discussed now, which really should be discussed, and which maybe then the Kenyan government, in collaboration with other governments, would say, okay, we need to kind of reduce the probability of these completely exogenous shocks where somebody unilaterally takes a decision as to what the situation is in our country. Now, like you say, that is political, it's complicated, but at the same time, it's also technical in the sense, because you should be able to identify what the objective situation really is in a particular area. So, again, that is something that I think where international cooperation can help a lot.
Yeah, I think the question is very interesting because actually it goes well beyond, let's say, dispute settlement procedures. It goes into the question of collaboration. It goes into the question of how a country can invest in its own brand and address misinformation. But no doubt there are issues out there, and sometimes they may have significant implications, for instance, for the tourism industry. Now, since you mentioned the dispute settlement, and this is often perceived as a crown jewel of the WTO, a system that it's working very well. For those that follow dispute settlement procedures, it's worth noting that the WTO just commemorated, quote-unquote, the 500th dispute settlement process through its years. But a very interesting aspect is that governments are not willing to fund the dispute settlement process in an effective manner, because over the many years we have a zero growth budget policy, and as a consequence, what the WTO Secretariat has to do is to play around with its staff to provide support to dispute settlement body. And I can tell you, the way that the system is evolving with the increased complexity of the cases that comes to the WTO, we may well see in the near future, if there are not additional resources or a different way to approach the financing of disputes in the WTO, we may see this system that is often referred as the crown jewel of the
negotiating pillar, there's the monitoring pillar, I guess you could call, which Bernard referred to, and then there's the disputes element. But there needs to be a balance between the three. I don't think it was ever conceived in terms of the way the WTO was set up for there to be trade rules developed through adjudication. The dispute settlement function, as I understand it, is really to interpret the existing rules and, you know, to qualify their application in practice, but not to develop new rules. But if we have a dearth of rule-making under the negotiating pillar, then obviously that is going to put some pressure on the dispute settlement part of the WTO in an increasingly complex environment. I would say the monitoring function is also very important to business because, and we saw the effectiveness of that post 2008 financial crisis. I think that the fact that the WTO was there with others to monitor what was going on didn't prevent new barriers to trade and investment from emerging, certainly hasn't resolved the capacity of the system to repeal those once they enter into force, but certainly averted potentially an all-out trade war that could have been a result of the financial crisis and then the global economic crisis. So the three elements of the WTO structure are very important, and business attaches importance to all three.
Very good. Additional questions? We have two here and here.
Okay. My name is Akasim Were from the University of Nairobi. I have questions for Kwame. We've been able to talk about trade in services for quite some time, and the challenge has been the data capture system. I don't know what measures have been put in place to try and be able to capture, because the figures given is 60%, 20%, 30%, but there's been no exact figures on how we are faring on in terms of data capture system. So I don't know whether there are any measures in place to try and do this. Then on the second part, I will maybe pose a question to Stefano. Despite the fact that he was very poetic, I could not get clearly some of the issues he was raising. But I wanted to find out what is currently being done with WTO. I have not heard any specific measures to rekindle the private sector interest in WTO, because most of the negotiations are inter-country, while the international trade at the moment is moving between trade between firms and organizations. So I think we need to be clear if we are country-specific or we are moving down to the firm level, and what specifically can we be able to change the system to try and work out this. Then the last part would be to either Carlos or Bernard, I don't know who, but in terms of capacity building and awareness, I think many people don't know much about WTO and what it does, and I think it's vital that the capacity be built. So I don't know how that is going to be addressed. And back to Kwame, I don't know, the negotiation teams from Kenya, I think we don't have much capacity in terms of negotiating at international level. I was an observer at one time, and it was very interesting to see how we go into meetings. The discussions are done in the morning before the actual day of discussion. You don't know which line items to handle. We don't know what to do. So I don't know what is being done, because in terms of capacity in international trade issues and relations, I think there's a problem. So I don't know what the National Economic and Social Council is doing about it. There was a national export guarantee scheme. I don't know how far it's gone. So I think it's something that needs to be shared. Thank you.
Very good. Kwame, why don't you start?
Okay. sorry. Well, I think if you look at Kenya's GDP, and over the last 30 or 40 years, there's been a consistency in terms of the expansion of services as a share of GDP. It's always been in the 50 to 60% range, fluctuates, but obviously that's it. I think those figures are fairly decent, well captured by the National Bureau of Statistics, and I mean, in whatever research or any analytical work that we do, we rely on them without second thought. So maybe we can share about that. So yes, unless you're talking about trade in services across, yes, that tends to be a little more difficult to capture. But basically, as a share of Kenya's GDP, I think the trade component is there. There are also international institutions that provide data, whether on a subscription basis, or basically summarized versions of the data telling you what the trade component of services has been. And many of them are solid estimates, but they usually tend to be around the ballpark. So I think all that is available. About the capacity of negotiation teams. Well, I think this, in my view, this is one of the other issues that many African countries, specifically in South, what we call the global South countries, ask for when they negotiate. I mean, it's an oxymoron of sorts that you ask those you're negotiating with to fund your negotiations. But I don't know whether the issue of capacity is real. I see a lot of people, I mean, professors in universities here and Kenyans who work abroad who are actually prepared to lend their expertise at no cost to government to enable us form. So that's the first. The second is when I go to the Ministry of Trade, and that happens maybe once every 2 months or once in a quarter, I see people who are capable and actually understand what's happening. So whether they are given the opportunity for that, the knowledge and their voice to actually shape trade policy is a different matter. And that's why I say I am less prepared to accept today that Kenya's problem is negotiating capacity, as much as it's basically how the institutions in which institutions are formed that allow for a coherent trade policy to emerge. So in a way, I think that, and this country is a big enough economy that if you're going to actually take some resources and put those resources in or rather invest those resources in ensuring that we have coherent trade policy, it should be possible. So again, it's a basically a political economy question and basically our own internal organization as opposed to whether the capacity exists or not. Thanks.
Stefano.
Thank you for the question. I hope I understood it correctly. There is a role for firms in this WTO process. It is an intergovernmental process, the actual negotiation, but as Joachim mentioned, it starts at the national level, I think, with structures and processes to co-opt the private sector and other stakeholders to bring forward their views and their recommendations to government to inform government policy and government positions within those intergovernmental negotiations. So I think what happens at the national level is very important, but of course in different countries those structures will organize themselves differently. And then there's a role for institutions such as the one I work for to play, which is to try and bring together business at a global multi-sectoral level to build cross-business consensus at a global level on recommendations that can be made to governments collectively in the intergovernmental context to inform their discussions. And the hope is that if business, for example, can bring a consensus set of recommendations to government, that will in turn facilitate consensus building among governments in terms of finding a solution to the to what they're trying to do. But at the same time, it does require, as Doug said, awareness raising. You know, this process is not necessarily well known to all, and I think even large actors and large companies may not always know everything that they need to know about it. I remember I was told a story at the time of the Uruguay round of a large firm that received a letter was sent by the Ministry of Trade to the CEO of the company saying, you know, the Uruguay round has just started and as a government we would like to know your firm's position on this and your offensive and defensive interests so that the government can build its own positioning in terms of those trade negotiations. And apparently a letter was sent out from the CEO's office, but without having been seen by the trade and investment policy manager within the company. And the letter said, dear minister, thank you very much for your letter and a kind offer of input, but our company doesn't trade much with Uruguay, so we don't have much to tell you.
Yeah, I heard this story before, and I don't know if it's true, but it's a good story. But one thing with respect to capacity building, and at IMD we have a program called the International Trading System that actually receives a very generous grant from Philip Morris International. And with this grant we are able to bring trade negotiators from developing countries to spend 1 week discussing trade negotiations, both at multilateral level and also in the context of regional agreements. One thing that I fully agree with you, Kwame, is that the quality of knowledge in terms of trade issues has improved a lot. And in the case of Kenya, for instance, we had two members, your ambassador in Geneva and a local secretary participating in this program this year, in June this year. So yes, there is lots of information nowadays, much better than was the case, for instance, during the Uruguay round. You can date me by saying that I was also involved in the Uruguay round negotiations as an academic and later as a World Bank official. But the one thing that it's very different is the question of having concrete experience in trade negotiations. Because in the words of my preferred American philosopher, Mike Tyson, everybody has a plan till they get the first punch in their mouth. So when you go into trade negotiations, things can change very quickly. And if you don't have experience, you just have the theory about trade negotiations, it's a little bit different. That's exactly why we bring people like Alejandro Jara, the former Deputy Director General of the WTO, and particularly in terms of his experience as trade negotiator for the Chilean US FTA and for many other FTAs that Chile negotiated, and of course, as a former WTO ambassador for Chile, to discuss exactly how you establish your agenda, how you prioritize the topics that you want to negotiate. This is an area that I would argue, and it's not only a question of developing countries. We had, for instance, in this program this year, countries like Serbia that are in the process of accession and that don't have this kind of experience. And this is not easy unless you have had the concrete engagement. So I think there is still lots of a role for engagement in terms of capacity building, which is much beyond, let's say, the theoretical aspects. But we had a question here in the front, and Doug also wants to say something. Let's take the question, and then we can both answer the question and say something.
Yeah, thank you very much, Lamputa from South Africa. I would like to use this opportunity to pick your brains and inform my own thinking around this as well. So I've got three sort of questions related. The one is, what is for you, you have been in Uruguay round negotiations, it could be either one of the panelists, what has changed since moving from the codes into a single undertaking and all the benefits that I was taught in Bern of the single undertaking, and now we're moving out of a single undertaking, now I have to push aside everything that I've learned of the value of a single reach negotiations. So I want to know from you that has the past experience, what has changed? Is it interest has changed? Is it some countries got what they want under the Uruguay, you know, like TRIPS or whatever, and they got it through the single undertaking, but now there's no need for a single undertaking. You put the pressure, you know,
you get the question. The second one for me is what to do about it. My understanding was that agriculture was posted because Article 20 of the of agricultural agreements got a built-in mechanism for the reform of agriculture. It's not only a Doha round issue.
Secondly, Doha round was posted as a round where the interests of developing countries would be placed at the heart. And then it seems to me the logic was because agriculture is like important for developing countries, very important, therefore
agriculture is elevated. And that sentiment is still there with developing countries. So I hear what Joachim is saying, that as long as,
I'm rephrasing, as long as agriculture trumps everything else, you won't see the
interest of private business.
But that assumes that, you know, there are interesting agricultural businesses as well in developing countries that wants to see a normalization in agricultural trade. Maybe not in developed countries because they've
got the agricultural agreement where they can
build out their businesses.
My third question would be very interesting on the structure of the talks. the structure of the talks. This value chain approach, are we saying, or am I hearing what Joachim was also saying, and Bernard, I think you also referred to it, that we shouldn't slice up NTB services, blah, blah, blah. In practice, how do you see, would we have like an energy agreement on covering both the whole energy value chain? Is that what you think that one? And then why don't we have an environmental goods and services agreement if that's the thinking around this and only stop at goods? Thank you for allowing me three questions.
Okay, another group of questions that probably would require a whole day. But let's start with Doug, who has not had a chance to say anything during the Q&A, and then we go one by one and we'll try to address your questions, Doug.
Well, in particular, I'd like to focus on the value chain. I think this is an interesting question, and some light has been shed on the issue. This also goes to an earlier question about services. The OECD has released a data set. There have been two iterations now called value-added trade. And what this data set permits you to do is to look at a value chain to see where the inputs are sourced by sector and by country of origin, you know, where they're processed, and then where the destination market is. The data set initially covered about 40 countries. I think now it's up to nearly 70. So it's a great resource. And I'll give you an example. We were assessing, we have a new paper actually issued by HSBC looking at the Trans-Pacific Partnership. And if you look, for example, at a country like Vietnam and how they participate in the value chain for motor vehicles, you can see the inputs, where they're drawn from. And in this industrial sector, something like a quarter of the inputs or more are coming from services. And many of those services are imported. And so this development is taking place in an environment where trade and services is constrained. So I think, one, it's an indication that there's strong demand, that businesses have figured out how to source these inputs internationally, despite the closed nature of some parts of the service sector. And two, it's an indication that with liberalization, we may see this expand and that it could be important to business, especially with there's virtualization in some areas of manufacturing where you see, instead of a manual switch, you see an electronic switch. There's electronic meaning digital, I think there's some interesting implications that could come from this where, you know, most of the value in a car now is coming from the software. If you're developing a new auto model, most of the cost is in the software. So anyhow, just to underscore the importance of this value chain, if you're trying to make the WTO and trade relevant to business, I think this value chain perspective is an important one that needs to be taken account of. And we have some new tools to do that.
Thank you. I'll just pick up on one of your questions. I don't purport to answer all of them, but you asked the question about the single undertaking versus what's happening today and the departure from it. My sense is that the negotiating environment and dynamics has changed a lot from the Uruguay round. I think under the Uruguay round, it was relatively simpler to take a single undertaking approach in the sense that negotiations were really led by a relatively smaller subset of WTO members, the Quad in particular, which could agree on things and then put it to the broader membership, and it was that sort of a dynamic. I think now with the great expansion of WTO membership to hopefully more than 163 at the end of this ministerial in a couple of days' time, and the vast majority of these members being from developing countries and several large emerging nations having risen in terms of their role in global trade, I think that those dynamics have become a lot more complicated and make a sort of single undertaking approach possibly more challenging than it once was. And maybe because of this greater diversity among WTO members, this greater level of participation among them, that is why the WTO is still trying to figure out how it addresses this need for greater flexibility. And maybe this greater flexibility can come from a blending of sort of pure multilateral type negotiations like the trade facilitation agreement, for example, with an approach that is more open plurilaterals like the ITA, for example.
Okay. On this, just to follow up on the single undertaking, so I think we need to distinguish terms in terms of what we're talking about, right? So I think what you need in terms of the theory, in terms of the practice, you need to be able to link issues. Right, because at the end of the day, you need to get everybody to get to yes, and there has to be enough on the table for everyone. Now, the single undertaking is one dimension of that, and I think one of the things we've learned, at least that's my interpretation of what's been going on the Doha round, is that for a single undertaking process to work, you need one, an agenda that everybody actually buys into in terms of making a deal on that, and you need good faith, right? Because the counterpart of the single undertaking approach is you give veto power to one individual country, and we've seen countries use that now. So if countries are, in a sense, not inclined to promote the collective good by saying, okay, I'm not getting everything I want, then the system breaks down. And I think that's what we've seen here. But that doesn't mean you don't need issue linking. So I think it really boils down to defining an agenda where you can actually link these issues, where everybody is basically on the same page in terms of what the trade-offs are going to have to be. And we don't have a situation where one or two or three countries at the end of the day says, okay, we've now spent 10 years negotiating. I'm going to reopen the whole deal because I didn't get what I wanted on issue A, right? So I think that's the counterpart of the single undertaking, which I think we're now suffering the consequences of. And I think that's why we really need to go to a system which is much more based on variable geometry, which allows, N minus one or N minus 10 countries to proceed, where there's clearly a large majority that says we're okay with moving forward on this agenda. So the value chain is one way of actually identifying what those issues might actually be that you want to link or that you should put on the table. So for me, I look at this value chain kind of notion as a way of identifying what the issues are that actually matter. Right, so what is a bundle, a set of issues that you can actually deal with jointly that will actually help improve the operations for business, help improve consumer welfare, what have you. So just to take the trade facilitation example. So we spent a lot of time talking, negotiating a trade facilitation agreement. That's great. Fixing customs is important. But we're not talking at all about transport. We're not talking about logistics. We're not talking about a whole variety of services that also enter into the equation. If you talk to a banker and you mention the word trade facilitation, he's going to think you're talking about trade finance, right? So obviously there's no trade finance dimension there. So I think you need to, again, approach this more holistically. So identifying the different dimensions that really matter for trade facilitation. And one of my worries about the trade facilitation agreement is we might spend too much time on customs and neglect some of these other dimensions that really matter in terms of bringing down costs.
Very good. Kwame.
Well, you asked about what to do about agriculture. And I think that definitely requires Solomonic wisdom. I'm not sure. I mean, in fact, agriculture itself under the DDA illustrates why single undertaking has challenges. So what's to be done about agriculture? My view is that we probably actually are at a point where we have to say, look, what is the basic minimum that we can actually get all members to agree on? And then we can park all those other issues to go along with other things. So there's an element in which I think that's frustrating because it says we are kicking the ball into the future. But I just see the, if I may use the word, hardening of positions and some of the vested interests that are here that are actually interested in specifically, not just agriculture, but in some cases, single things such as, say, cotton, or one thing or this or the other, or sudden subsidies. It's difficult, I think partly because, and in my view, this also shows why inclusiveness has its own challenge. As the system has become more inclusive, obviously there are many more interests and the variety of people who have peculiar interests, just like happens in domestic policies is. So I don't have a great answer for you. It's only that, look, we have to get to a point where we say, what is the minimum that we can take regarding agriculture so far, if it means some principles, and then the rest perhaps provide a timeline and we can resolve them step by step over time as we build confidence with one another. Thanks.
Excellent. We are running out of time. I'm not going to summarize what we discussed. In one word, it was good. In two words, not good, in the sense that we have not yet solved how to rekindle the interest of the private sector. But this last group of questions is a very relevant one in terms of the system, not necessarily, let's say, topics that the private sector is directly interested. The preservation of the system, of course, we heard from ICC, but from individual companies, of course, the objectives are much more specific. But one thing that it's quite clear is that time is running out for the Doha agenda, simply because, and agriculture is a very good example, in 2001, when the negotiations started, the basic issues were distortions in countries from the European Union and in countries like the United States. And that's why when we had in 2003, before Cancun, a proposal that, again, it's a good example, when two of the big boys, quote unquote, were able to come together and to make a proposal for progress in agriculture, this generated significant resistance that led to the creation of the G20, not the economic G20, but the WTO G20, under the leadership of a very heterogeneous group of countries. Brazil, Argentina, with a very strong export interests on one hand, and then countries like India with very different interests. At that point in time, that made sense because they had one basic objective, which was to address the distortions in industrialized countries in the area of agriculture. Nowadays, if we go back to the same team, you can see that the G20, the agricultural G20, is in serious trouble, not only because of different positions in terms of export interests, aggressive export interests for a country like Brazil, vis-a-vis food security for a country like India, and of course very different agendas. But more than that, if we ask where are the main subsidies nowadays, they are in China. So the elephant in the room in this whole system is that as time went by, we really didn't have the mechanisms to address in an efficient manner these distortions. And now we have an agenda that is totally surpassed by the reality of world trade. So this gets back to the question of single undertaking. Will single undertaking survive? I have one prophecy, and the only one that I'll leave with you is that no, single undertake will not survive. We are going to go back to a world where, as Bernard suggests, multiple geography and plurilateral solutions are going to be pursued. Does this mean that it will be pursued in the context of the Doha agenda? Well, you don't need to be a weatherman to see how the wind is blowing. Just read the USTR statement yesterday in the Financial Times. So with this, thank you very much for those who took the time and join me in thanking the panel for their interventions.